Hi everyone, it's Mandy here, and I'm really, really happy today to introduce you to one of my soul sisters, one of my bestest friends in the whole world. And she is a heart medicine mama. It's Gria Ashley from Tasmania. And Gria, I'm so happy to have you here, but would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. So thank you for having me. It's so cool to connect in this way. I'm Gria, and it's interesting when you say, what do I call myself? And my first response is like, Gria. And then you're like, no, as in like, what do you do? And it's like, I've come up with the term heart medicine mama because I'm qualified in lots of different areas and different veins of my life. But really, when it comes down to it, I really believe that love is the ultimate medicine. And I've learned that through my own journey of really feeling like it wasn't okay for me to be honest about who I really was, and feeling like I needed to adapt based on how I was supposed to be, and judging myself for not feeling happy and satisfied with this life that I should be happy with, and all these things. And it's really been my own journey of coming deeper and deeper into my heart that I realized that that is the ultimate medicine. And I'm a mum of three, and I know that mothering is a big part of my journey and mission here, but what I've really come to see is actually my mothering of myself, becoming my own, nurturer, and then holding that space for others too, including mums, but kind of everyone. So, yeah.
It's so beautiful because this is an area of life I feel that's been so overlooked for so long. And so often we're here to serve, and we're here to serve everyone else. And, you know, people like you are really keen to serve the mamas. And it's I find maybe it's just a generational thing, but finally people are saying, hang on, I have to look after myself, you know. And I'm from a nursing background, you're from a care background, you've done all sorts of coaching, and you've always been there to support everyone, and it comes a point where you're like, I think learning to nurture and care for yourself is something you have to learn. For me, yeah, it doesn't come naturally, I always roll back into not doing it. And so, is this something that you sort of specialize in, is teaching people to start with looking after themselves?
Yeah, in a way, yes, but it's more about really nurturing ourselves with gentleness and self-compassion. So how that might look, you know, in terms of playing out our lives are things like food, which, I have sought your counsel so many times on food around the years, and you know, those daily habits and rituals that we can do, and kind of different embodiment practices. But for me, it's really about the mind. And although I don't in any way specialize in the mind, it kind of has to start with that to some degree, of just being willing to bring in compassion. And compassion is probably more of a feeling than a mental story, as I say that. But it's guiding people into compassion. And really, what's been one of my greatest motivators for that is because of my desire to be of service, and realizing that really simply to be seen for who we are and without judgment, that I've really wanted to be able to offer that space for others, and knowing that I can only offer that to the extent that I offer that myself. So that's been a really big motivator for me, and just being kind to myself. You know, it's been super cool. I've recently started Pilates about 8 weeks ago, and it's the first time, because I hadn't really exercised for like a year and a half, like a regular kind of fitness exercise, and had a baby and pretty much pregnant and having a baby, and I've just been getting back into it. And what I've loved so much is I've noticed such a big shift in my mental story when I go there, because there's all these like young 20-year-olds with these like peachy butts and like just looking amazing. I'm like, oh my god, Pilates is like such an amazing secret for peachy butts. But instead of comparing myself or going, oh god, you know, I'm not enough, and all like getting motivated, I'm gonna have a butt like that and then I'll be enough, you know, kind of that thing, it's just like, I don't know, I'm just not judging myself. I'm like, just totally celebrating myself for being there and nourishing my body and looking after myself. And I find their picture butts inspiring, but in a really good way, like just like, oh my God, it's so cool, you know, and I just go there and have fun. And that's kind of a funny example, but yeah, there's a big difference between, like, I've had periods in my life where I've been really quite fit, but my mental talk, like, it's almost like the fitter I got, the harder I got on myself. Whereas now, like, just tending to myself, like I would, like, if my six-year-old came to me and said, oh, mommy, I feel like I'm not very good at soccer or something. I'm like, honey, you know, have fun, and, you know, being talking to myself like I would my own child. That's just been a big part of it.
Oh, I love that. Yeah, and it's something we all need. You know, I really liked what you said about coming from that place of being rather than doing, you know, like when you're super fit and you're like, I've got to get up in the morning and I've got to run 10K and then I'm going to run a marathon and then I'll have a six pack and great guns and a peachy butt and then I'll be happy, you know?
Yeah.
And we're always putting our happiness in the future, right? You know, rather than just going, okay, what about I just get to be amazing and beautiful and, you know, heartfelt right now and love myself right now rather than waiting for that, you know, pump the body gym 16-week session to be up, you know, when I think then I'll be right.
Yeah, totally. And even things, you know, as you say that, I'm remembering, like, I was living on my own when I my marriage ended and I moved out on my own for a while down at Cliffy, a place you know well. And my beloved now, Aaron, he was kind of interstate and we, you know, we weren't necessarily planning on being in a long-term relationship. And so I was on my own and living on my own for the first time ever. And what I used to do is I used to, like, do the housework and make my bed. And I would act as if I was making the bed for the queen. And so rather than go, fuck, I've got to make the bed and, like, it being a chore, I just, like, did it as a devotional act of service. And it was so beautiful. Like, my house, it was never like, I'm not like a clean freak by any means, but I just started creating this space like I would if a woman, like the queen or someone who I would actually really care to, you know, as an esteemed guest was coming to my home. That's how I kind of prepared for it, but I was doing it for myself. Like you. Exactly. So, and that was really beautiful to do that. And then I'd, like, get to go to bed at nighttime. I'd have all the candles lit and everything. I'd be like, oh my God, this is so beautiful. And just, like, giving that to myself, that was super powerful. And just being kind to myself. And yeah.
That's divine. I mean, so many people I speak to, especially in the world I'm in, you know, I work with a lot of, you know, the luxury lifestyle crew, you know, the jet crew, the yacht crew, and the wives of the, you know, the yacht captains that have three kids and are super busy parenting them. And everyone's in such a rush. And we're always waiting for that secret, that next thing to land. And it doesn't take long to make your slow down, to make your bed like you're making it for the queen, does it? You know, it's probably the difference of a second, but it's the intention behind it, isn't it? Like, it's not like you're suddenly just spending your whole time wafting around making your space beautiful. It's just the way you're doing it. And it probably doesn't even probably takes less time actually because you're so aware, right?
Yeah. And for me, like, I just tend to, like, in some ways as a mum, I just drop my standards.
Yeah.
Like, in some areas of my life. So the house at the moment, like, I could show, the house is actually pretty clean at the moment, but sometimes the house just kind of gets a bit chaotic. And so I just choose a space. And for me, it's the bedroom. That's the area that I really love to keep clean so that I see, and I co-sleep with our baby. So mind you, like, it will get a bit messy for a few days, but then I'll just like, okay, I'm going to do this. But it's the mindset behind it around, okay, I'm going to create this space and make it really a beautiful space to be in rather than I've got to clean it every day, you know? So, and the other thing I do is just bring in pauses and say no to my daughters quite often if they want to do things and it's going to be like, get from school, go to swimming, go to da, 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 da. I'm just like, nah, sorry, we can't do that because I don't want them to grow up thinking that that's normal or that that's good or healthy. And sometimes if I notice we are rushing and we go, if like, especially if we've got to get to swimming or something, we'll get in the car and then I just stop and I consciously take 5 seconds, okay, and say, okay, girls, let's just take a breath in and go. And so they're just learning to pop in those little pauses and it takes 5 seconds. And then I like bend time. I use theta. I did it with Pearl yesterday on her way to her Nate appointment. I was like, all right, Pearl, let's bend time. And say, so we'll go 2 o'clock and like blew it out to there. And then we're just like in total flow in the traffic. I'm like, see, we don't have like, notice how like the more we relax, the more we cruise and ride through life. And it was just epic. And the other day we were on our way and we were running late and then we saw dolphins in the river. I go, what? Let's stop and pulled over and just took the time to go see the dolphins. I'm like, check them out. They're so beautiful. And then, oh, back in the car. And both times we got to the appointment like within 1 minute of it starting. Like just total flow. It was epic.
Oh, so beautiful. And that's such great advice for people too, is to take those moments and play. Yeah. You know, ask to bend time or make more time. Or I did that the other day. I was feeling rushed and I was running late for an appointment. And I was like, what if I could just bend time? Imagine, you know, and I put myself in that kind of zone. And same thing, I got there. I don't know how it happened. Like, it was like, I created so much time. And I was like, how's this?
Yeah. It's epic, hey? And you know what? The little tip on that is that I owe to my dear friend, my wife, Amy Murphy. I remember we used to work together back in like my former life when I was working in regional development, and we used to run workshops around the state. And I remember I picked her up in the car and we're driving, and we had to drive down to like Huonville, which is like a good 50-minute drive, right, from Hobart. And I remember saying to her, like, I think our workshop was starting at 10:30 and it was 9:30. So we had like an hour to drive there and be set up for the workshop to start, like, which is not enough time. And I got it, she got in the car and I was like, oh, we're late. And like traffic was long. She goes, no, we're not. We're like an hour early. I was like, oh yeah. And it really stuck with me because, and now, although we were running late, we weren't late. Like we still had an hour to get there. Like even if it would have taken an hour and a half. And I really took that on. And it means that even though I think we ended up only being like getting there, like, we started the workshop 10 minutes late, but rather than stressing out for that 1 hour thinking, oh, we're going to be late, I was just like, cool, we're still early, we're still early, we're still early. So by the time we got to like, we're going to start, okay, we're going to start like 10 minutes later, and we just let people know. And it just, it really, something so simple, it has really stuck with me like 10 years on.
Oh, I love it. I think it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. Now what's one of my last questions that I think everyone in the audience is going to love is, what could be like your top three secrets to coming from the heart more and slowing down more? Where would you start if you had no idea what to do?
That's a good question. It's like trusting the whispers, so that like pulling, I kind of want to do this. So trusting the whispers, being with the fears. So when a fear comes, oh, I want to do this. It's like, oh, but this, okay, I'm going to be with you. And then just like, and then what would that, and then, okay, so I've been pulsed to do something. This fear comes up, I'm going to be with it. Okay, what would be the first step if I were to do it? What would be the most nourishing step, the most compassionate step towards whatever it is that I'm wanting to do? And that could be something as simple as, like, a really good example. I just went to the soccer field and I was going there, and there was like, it was my daughters and my ex-in-laws were down from the mainland for the first time. So I was seeing them all for the first time since I'd separated like 4 years ago. And I like sat there in meditation before, and I just played Aung San Waheguru, really got in my heart. And then I was like totally in my heart. And then as I went to leave the car, I had this fear come up. What if I'm not received? And so I was with that. And then I was like, okay, what's the next step? It's like, okay, I just get out of the car and open my heart. And that was it. And I had the most beautiful catch up with them. It was awesome. Just big hugs and